William Morrow and Harper Audio present Love and Other Crimes, Stories by Sara Paretsky, performed by Susan Ericksen. Introduction. I grew up in a time and place and milieu where a lot was expected of women inside the home, but not much outside it. I was supposed to get married, raise a family, but work as a secretary until that happy day arrived. I finished university, but was not married nor on my way to that estate, and so I worked as a secretary. At the same time, I began a graduate degree in history, without much focus or direction. The one thing I did with concentrated pleasure was read crime fiction. I went to the used bookstores in my neighborhood and picked up paperbacks for a dime. Those were the days. I read the small collection in the University of Chicago Library. They chiefly collected writers from the so-called English Golden Age. I read Christie, Sayers, Allingham, Marsh. In a break from Tudor Puritanism and Victorian science, I took an elective on popular fiction by one of the early giants in popular culture studies, John Cowellty. I read Carol John Daly and Dashiell Hammett. The Golden Age writers had a lot of love, conducted in elegant repartee, but not much sex. The American noir writers had a lot of sex, but not much love. The love in the books came from the readers, namely the passion we brought to what we were reading. At one point, the women in the small office where I worked simultaneously came under the spell of Lord Peter Wimsey. He was sensitive, elegant, witty, accomplished. He drove a cool car. We swooned as we compared notes during our coffee breaks. One day, we agreed to ask the people we were dating why they didn't make love to us in the French language. I can't remember what anyone else reported, but when I put the question to Courtney, whom I was dating, and some years later married, he gave me a groucho leer and said, "Voulez-vous fucker?" Definitely the American hard-boiled school. In Strong Poison, Wimsey asks Miss Clemson, who runs an inquiry agency for him, why people kill each other. "There is passion," said Miss Clemson with a slight hesitation at the word, "for I should not like to call it love when it is so unregulated." We kill out of passion. We kill out of love. Love of money, but also love of family, a desire to protect those for whom we feel responsible. We kill to protect our reputations, to protect property. We kill out of a narcissistic wound when we've been betrayed or abandoned. We kill for revenge. I wrote the stories in this collection over a period of about 20 years. Some predate the internet and smartphones, some are on the cusp of changes in the publishing industry, but almost all of them feature people who kill for love. Family love crops up over and over in this collection. In the title story, where the big kids protect the baby brother, in Wildcat, where VI tries to protect her father, in Is It Justice?, where another sister looks after another brother. In Acid Test, a highly disciplined young engineer goes to bat to save the aging hippie mother she can't help loving. Miss Bianca features a 10-year-old girl who loves a laboratory mouse. Two of the stories are my homage to my own first love, the crime fiction of the late Victorian and early 20th century eras. Murder at the Century of Progress features the progenitor of noir detectives, Race Williams, side by side with the kind of elderly spinster beloved of Anna Katharine Green and Agatha Christie. The curious affair of the Italian art dealer plays games with the master of all investigators, Sherlock Holmes. I tweak him a little. Anna Catherine Green's Leavenworth case preceded a study in Scarlet by a good 10 years. Her sleuths, Ebenezer Grice and Amelia Butterworth, practiced many of the deductive and observational arts that Holmes is known for. Her books topped bestseller lists in England and the States. Conan Doyle is known to have studied Green's marketing practices and even wrote to her, hoping for a personal meeting with her when he first came to America. She lived in Buffalo, New York. It's not known if the meeting ever took place, but I wanted to bring Green and her female sleuth back into people's minds, and this story was my chance to do so. Another story in the collection that I loved writing is the final one, Heartbreak House. I wrote it for the collection Murder for Love. We were supposed to write love stories, and so I created a romance writer and a cornucopia of love stories. As for me, I love, not necessarily in this order, my husband, my dog, chocolate, my 1995 Jaguar convertible, my friends, the United States Constitution, early music, the Bill of Rights, peace, singing, cortados, justice, walking Chicago's lakefront, reading fiction, clean water. I might even kill to protect and defend them. Sara Paretsky, Chicago, November 2019. Love and Other Crimes. 1.
"They're trying to frame Gregory," she announced baldly.
"Who are they? Who is Gregory? And what are they saying he did?" I asked.
"Fucking Warshawski snob," she said. "I might have known. Like your mother, too good to walk around the planet with the ordinary mortals."
"Anyone who compares me to my mother is paying me the highest possible compliment.
But I still don't..."
"Oh, Gregory? Baby Gregory? Are you Sonia Litvak?" She'd given her name as Sonia Geary when she made the appointment.
"I got married. Did you think that was impossible?" she jeered.
She saw my inadvertent glance at her bare left hand.
"It didn't last. Neither did yours, what I heard. But you had to keep your own name, didn't you? No one else could be as good as a Warshawski."
"Do you want to tell me who framed Gregory for what?" I asked. "Or just needle me about my family?"
"I want you to understand I don't need any Warshawski pity or handouts. I came here for help, and I plan to pay your bill."
"That assumes I agree to help you," I snapped.
"But you have to."
She was astonished.
"You're from South Houston, same as me. And I need a private cop to go up against the city. Although, come to think of it, your father was a Chicago cop, and if you insult my father on top of my mother, you'll have to leave." "Oh, don't get your undies in a bundle," she grumbled. "I never went to finishing school."
It was as close as she would come to an apology. I turned away to type Gregory Litvak's name into a legal database, and he popped right up, charged with second-degree homicide along with criminal destruction of property. 10 days ago, someone, allegedly Gregory Litvak, had gone through the Rockamina warehouse and smashed about $25 million worth of wine and booze. Sonia was reading over my shoulder.
"See, I told you, they framed him for this."
"Sonia, this doesn't prove anything about anyone." I scrolled down the screen. Rockamina had fired Gregory a week or so before the destruction. The state and the liquor distributor claimed he sought revenge by rampaging through the warehouse. He might still have made bail, but the crime held a second, more serious offense. When the cleanup crew started hauling out the debris, they'd found the body of Eugene Horvath mixed in with the broken bottles in aisle 97. Horvath was Rockamina's accountant. The state's theory was that Gregory blamed him for losing his job.
They fired Gregory for no reason, Sonia burst out. And then, because they feel guilty, they have to frame him for destroying the warehouse and killing Horvath. The Rockaminas probably did it themselves to collect insurance.
What made the police pick up Gregory? I asked.
His prints were on the forklift. Well, of course his prints were on the forklift. He drove it for them, loading and unloading crap for them all day. 18 years he worked there, and then, bingo, he's getting close to being 100% vested. Out the door with him. I need you to prove he didn't do it.
She glared fiercely. When she'd been young, carting baby Gregory around, her hair grew in lopsided clumps around her head, as though she got her brother Donnie to cut it for her. Today, the thick curls, dyed bright orange, were symmetrically shaped. Her face was covered with the armor of heavy makeup, but beneath that, she was still the ungainly, needy girl of 15. Sonia didn't want Warshawski pity, and I didn't want to give her any, so it annoyed me to find myself stirred by it. He has a lawyer, right? Or is he in the system?
The public defender. We're trying to put the money together for a real lawyer, but we can't even make bail right now. They set it for $2 million. Who can come up with that kind of money? Reggie could help, but he won't. Taking his brats to Disney World instead of taking care of his own flesh and blood.
I didn't think suggesting that his children were also Reggie's flesh and blood would help. Instead, I laboriously pried details from her. Reggie had moved to Elgin with his own little company. Sonia was vague about what they did, but it had something to do with computers. She seemed to think Reggie had become another Gates or Jobs and that he wouldn't help Gregory out of spite. Donnie worked for Klondike Insurance. This was an agency that had the inside track on a lot of city and county business, which somehow, inevitably, also seemed to mean some of their clients were mob fronts. It sounded as though he was the agency's handyman, repairing broken machines, changing light bulbs, ordering supplies. I could picture him siphoning off supplies and selling them on Craigslist, but not engineering the big deals that make a successful mobster.
So it's not like Donnie's got a lot of money, Sonia was continuing to whine, and then his ex is sucking the marrow out of his bones. He doesn't even get to see the kid except weekends. And then the kid doesn't want to hang around Donnie because Donnie doesn't have a PlayStation or any of that crap.
Stanley can't help? I asked.
He dropped all the way out. Sonia snorted. First, he was in business with Reggie, but he said late-stage capitalism was draining his lifeblood, whatever the fuck that means. He lives in a cabin in the hills somewhere in Arizona and thinks great thoughts. Or maybe it's no thoughts.
That left baby Gregory.
Gregory is super smart, Sonia said. Like he had really high ACT scores, so Daddy wanted him to go to college. He even got a scholarship to go to the University of Illinois, but then he never went. So Daddy threw him out of the house, which was when I was married and he lived with me. Then Ken threw him out, which led to me beating Ken up and him getting an order of protection and then a divorce. Anyway, that's when Donnie found Gregory a job at Rockamina's, and he's been there ever since. Until they fired him for no reason at all.
They must have told him something. She tossed her head, but the orange curls didn't move. She must have sprayed some kind of epoxy on them.
Ask him yourself. Maybe you can turn on some Warshawski charm, and he'll tell you stuff he won't talk to me about.
The chin beneath the thick makeup wobbled. She fished in her handbag and blew her nose, a good loud honk.
You gonna help me or not?
Not, I chanted silently. Not, not, not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.